One of life's little pleasures that I really enjoy is when I get on Netflix and I see a movie I either haven't seen in a while, or better yet, a movie I wanted to watch but Netflix didn't have at the time. I was fortunate enough to be in this situation a few months ago when I saw the Dynasty Warriors movie front and center on the recommended list, like Netflix knew me or something. After recovering from my mind being completely blown, I immediately added it to my list, because of course I'm gonna watch this movie again and again. I canceled my plans for the night. For some reason, I remember it being a Friday, and I sat down to see what this movie had in store for me. Well, I gotta say, I absolutely loved it. But not for the reasons you're probably thinking of. Now, is this a good movie? No. No, it is not. But that's not the point. This movie wasn't for the general public, in my opinion. It was for Dynasty Warriors fans worldwide. You guys just won't appreciate this movie like we will. I'm actually amazed I actually enjoyed the movie as much as I did. I've been a Dynasty Warriors fan for damn near 2 decades. My first Dynasty Warriors game was ironically Dynasty Warriors 4 Extreme Legends, the expansion companion game for the mainline game Dynasty Warriors 4. And I can't tell you how frustrated I was with the game at the time, because I found the Extreme mode too easy and the Legend mode was cool, but it had its limitations. However, I could play Ma Chao's Legend stage all day long. Eventually, I got my hands on Dynasty Warriors 4, still my favorite game in the series, by the way, and my love for the series was cemented forever. I have been fortunate enough to be able to play almost every Dynasty Warriors game that has come out in the West, except for the first game in the series, which ironically was a fighting game, and all the games that came out on PSP. So, yeah, I did play the game that should not be named on Game Boy Advance. I don't want to talk about it. Basically, I grew up with Dynasty Warriors, and the series is a perfect example of how the gaming industry has evolved in both good and bad ways. But that is a video for another day. The first time that I heard Dynasty Warriors was getting a movie was on some random article while I was looking something up on Google, and this was my reaction.
You serious?
I didn't think it was a good idea, especially since the track record for video game movies at the time was not good at all. In fact, it was terrible. However, like I said, I was pleasantly surprised by the movie. I was originally going to make a pros and cons list to keep this video very easily digestible and easy to understand, but I decided against it. When it comes to pros and cons lists in the Dynasty Warriors community, no one does it better than Chris Gildart. Chris, if you ever see this video, please forgive me. I didn't want you to be like,
"He copied my whole fucking flow! Word for word, bar for bar!"
Especially if I do it badly. So I'm just going to categorize everything. Please forgive me for the many mispronunciations that are about to come your way. You'd think with how long I've been playing these games and learn more about the history by doing my own research, I would be way better with the names. But I've accepted that I'm just hopeless in that department. The Dynasty Warriors storyline can be mainly split into three parts, and I'm going to stick to the battles in the storyline instead of the actual history, just so I don't confuse anyone. The first part covers the time period between the Yellow Turban Rebellion to the Battle of Cherbi. The second part covers Liu Bei's rise to power in Shu and the official start of the Three Kingdoms era to the Battle of Yi Ling. The final part covers the latter half of the Three Kingdoms period to the rise of the Jin Dynasty. The movie mainly covers the first half of the first part of the entire storyline. I know it's a little confusing.
Hey, you've got this.
One thing a lot of people fail to understand is how complex the actual time period the Dynasty Warriors story depicts actually is. The game actually does a lot of simplification so players can just have a smooth playing experience instead of having them worry about various characters and what they're doing in between battles. Since the movie doesn't have to worry about that hurdle, it can take its time to focus on the lead up to each potential battle in the movie's narrative. For example, nowhere in the myriad of Dynasty Warriors games have they ever touched on Liu Bei's time as a county magistrate like the movie does. I mean, sure, the movie doesn't spend a lot of its runtime on this part of Liu Bei's story, but I did appreciate its inclusion. The game also covers Cao Cao's failed assassination attempt on Dong Zhuo, which the game started portraying in the 7th installment of the series. These two scenes are vital parts of the narrative since they explain what our main characters are doing in between the time of the Yellow Turban Rebellion to the Battle of Hulao Gate, where the third major faction will be introduced to the story, the Sun family. Unfortunately, they barely have any scenes in the movie and it's damn near criminal. The movie does not waste any time throwing you right into the action as we watch Dong Zhuo lead the forces of the Han Empire against the leader of the Yellow Turbans, Zhang Jiao, and his forces. I have a love for Asian war movies because they always nail their battle scenes, and this movie definitely nailed the skill of battles in the Dynasty Warriors games. At the core of every Warriors title, there is a gigantic battlefield where the player controls a character whose drip is on point most of the time, with some sweet-looking weapons pulling off moves that defy the laws of gravity as they defeat thousands of people. The battle initially goes well for the Han, but all is not as it seems because Zhang Jiao is making preparations to cast a spell to turn the tide. Going back to the games, the Yellow Turban Rebellion is always treated as a tutorial for most players as they start playing. Most of the time, Zhang Jiao and his two brothers Zhang Bao and Zhang Liang always have some magic to throw at you as you fight them. For example, in Dynasty Warriors 3, Zhang Bao throws giant boulders at you when you start getting close to him.
Feel the power of my magic!
Oh god, I love the turbo voice acting of the older games.
You flaming idiot! Take this!
In fact, this is a favorite of the game developers, seeing Zhang Bao throws boulders at you in damn near every game. In the movie, Zhang Jiao turns his men into zombies. And now that I think about it, I'm very surprised they never did that in the games. I mean, sure, there were the Phantom Soldiers, but those aren't the same. Back to the movie, Liu Bei, one of the central figures of the period and one of the movie's two main characters, plus his two sworn brothers Guan Yu and Zhang Fei, show up to save the Han forces, and together the Allied forces triumph over the Yellow Turbans. I loved the game callbacks during the battle. Then we have the previously mentioned Liu Bei and Cao Cao developments before we get to the best set of scenes in the entire movie.
And now for something completely different.
After the Yellow Turban Rebellion was quelled, one thing was made evidently clear. The Han was no longer the power it once was, and it was ripe for the taking. A few things happened behind the scenes in the story that Dynasty Warriors unfortunately does not do a good job of highlighting that I feel needed to be mentioned. First, Emperor Ling died tragically, leaving his two young sons plus a huge power vacuum behind. His death led to a conflict between the Han Grand Commandant, He Jin, and the 10 eunuchs, who over time had been gaining more and more power. This conflict led to the death of He Jin, which in turn led to a massacre of the 10 eunuchs by Imperial forces. However, some of the eunuchs were able to escape the massacre with the fallen Emperor's young sons in tow. But they were caught by Dong Zhuo's forces, who were returning to the capital at the time. The remaining eunuchs committed suicide, and the now Emperor, Emperor Shao, and his little brother were brought back to the capital. However, this was damn near the worst scenario. Dong Zhuo went full dictatorship, which led the warlords of the Han to create a coalition against him with the goal of rescuing the Emperor and saving the Han Empire. Okay, please understand this. I really dumbed down this sequence of events, which hopefully should make this video flow better, and I don't want to have you be confused that much by how things got from where they were with the Yellow Turban Rebellion to the series of scenes I'm about to talk about. Now we're all caught up. Oh yeah, by the way, remember Emperor Shao? Dong Zhuo kills him and installs his younger brother, now named Emperor Xian, as the emperor. So yeah, this man was the ultimate heel. Going back to the movie, my favorite part of the entire movie is when the coalition gathers under the leadership of Yuan Shao, and here is where we first see Sun Jian and his two sons, who will eventually form the Kingdom of Wu. Liu Bei and his sworn brothers also pull up to the coalition's gathering point, but are initially turned away because of his lack of notoriety, despite him actually receiving an invite. Things almost get hostile before Cao Cao pulls up with his army. To spare you the next series of events, there's a lot of ass kissing and fake flexing going on, as we see the coalition is not as solid as it appears. Dong Zhuo also learns about the Coalition's gathering point, and despite the ferocious Lu Bu volunteering to launch a preemptive strike on the Coalition, Dong Zhuo sends Hua Shang instead. While Dong Zhuo's forces head toward the Coalition, Sun Jian volunteers to be the Coalition's vanguard, with Yuan Shao floating a high rank in the Han Empire as a reward for the first person who enters the capital. Sun Jian leaves, and this is where the scene really gets good. Man, I feel really bad just saying that. Hua Shang and his forces arrive, and he proceeds to talk his mess. I really like this because Hua Shang doesn't really get his just due in the games due to his early placement in the Dynasty Warriors story, but I love the fact that he got some time to shine in the movie. So as Hua Shang continues his trash talk, various warriors step up to face him, but Hua Shang racks up quite a kill streak.
Gain the lead. Double kill.
During this killstreak, Guan Yu attempts to step up, but Liu Bei stops him until just the right moment.
Kilimanjaro, Kiltastrophe, Killpocalypse.
Eventually, Guan Yu goes out and kills Hua Shang, earning himself and his brothers great fame. Once news of Hua Shang's death reaches Dong Zhuo, Lu Bu is then sent out to fight the Coalition, and Dong Zhuo gathers the rest of his forces for a massive battle. Cao Cao and Liu Bei then have this weird mountaintop duel where they come up with a plan to get into the capital. Liu Bei will borrow troops from the members of the Coalition to hold off Lu Bu while Cao Cao and Sun Jian try to get into the capital. When Lu Bu and Liu Bei's forces meet, this is where the movie says fuck it and proceeds to blow the entire special effects budget. I don't think I can accurately describe the fight between the Sworn Brothers and Lu Bu. It's fascinating, terrible, funny, captivating, and eye-roll worthy all at the same time. It may be the closest thing we'll ever get to a Dynasty Warriors Strike Force live-action movie without actually going full Strike Force. Okay, let me be serious. The fight has a lot of Dynasty Warriors callbacks and homages, especially to the Dynasty Warriors 7 opening for some reason. Also, all the elemental effects made me smile. It was good to see Guan Yu had equipped his fire orb right before the fight. I don't know if the lightning orb was a good choice, Lu Bu, but hey man, you do you. There is a reason though why it was only in Dynasty Warriors 4. Eventually, Liu Bei's distraction is successful as Cao Cao and Sun Jian make it to the capital, but they find the capital empty and ransacked as Dong Zhuo moved to the old Han capital of Chang'an. Lu Bu retreats as well, but not before telling the Sworn Brothers not to die before they meet up again. Cao Cao actually opts to pursue Lu Bu and lets Sun Jian enter the capital, thereby effectively giving the rank that was promised by Yuan Shao to Sun Jian. This turned out to be a very faithful decision because Sun Jian would find the Imperial Seal during their stay in the capital. The Imperial Seal is the symbol of Imperial authority of the Han Empire, and Sun Jian takes the seal home with him, and by doing that, basically made himself the enemy of the entire empire. Cao Cao would fail in his pursuit as well, but would bounce back gracefully. And after a random 3-year time skip, he is now a force to be reckoned with Liu Bei nurturing a little force of his own. The two meet again and we get the two heroes conversation, which is an iconic cutscene in my opinion in the Dynasty Warriors story as the movie ends. Overall, the movie's story quality is very inconsistent in my opinion. I wish they found a better way to mix the Dynasty Warriors story with the actual story it was based on. I think every newcomer to Dynasty Warriors, and by proxy, the Romance of the Three Kingdoms story will learn is how complex the story can actually be. With so many moving parts and defining moments, I don't think even a trilogy of movies can suffice. I think you might need an MCU level of commitment here. Hell, Liu Bei's time in the Jing province alone leading up to the Battle of Chirbi deserves its own movie. Hell, maybe a couple. I don't know how you don't give the Battle of Chang'an its own movie. Okay, I can already tell some of you are going to be confused by what I just said, so let me explain. The Battle of Chang'an is a great way to start the climax of the first part of the Dynasty Warriors story. It's basically what the Battle of Wakanda in Avengers Infinity War was in the Infinity Saga. The battle serves as a demonstration of how powerful Cao Cao has become, with him becoming the most powerful warlord of the era after his victory over Yuan Shao in the Battle of Guandu. He doggedly pursues Liu Bei across the Jing province. In fact, he was so powerful, he got the actual lord of the province to surrender without a fight, leaving Liu Bei to fight Cao Cao alone. However, in Liu Bei's darkest hour, he was able to secure the services of a man who would change the entire course of history. The sleeping dragon, Zhuge Liang. Yeah, the guy from this anime. The battle also highlights the Dynasty Warriors poster boy Zhao Yun's quest to retrieve Liu Bei's son from deep behind enemy lines. We have Zhang Fei stand on the Changban Bridge. These moments, along with Zhuge Liang showing off his genius, helped Liu Bei escape and set up the climactic Battle of Chirby. By the way, while all this is happening, Sun Quan, the second son of Sun Jian, has finished solidifying himself following the sudden death of his brother, Sun Ce, who took over after their father, Sun Jian, was killed in an ambush due to him acquiring the Imperial Seal. He has been watching the events unfold with increasing interest. Also, there is still the lingering problem of the rebels in the Liang province to the west. Hopefully you see what I mean by my explanation of how complex the story is. Now, obviously, I know what's going on due to the fact I've been playing the games for damn near 2 decades, plus my interest in the period as well. However, I feel so bad for any newcomer to the series as they watch this. There just isn't enough setup, in my opinion, to make the movie flow as well as it could have. But as a fan, I'm not going to lie, I loved it. First things first, before I talk about the good and bad, this has to be said. What the hell is this?
Oh my god, bro.
Oh, hell no, man. What the fuck, man?
I need to talk about the portrayal of Guan Yu. I'm sorry, but this ain't it, Chief. I understand that accurately depicting a character to match their video game counterpart is damn near impossible. And I would totally let this go if this movie was just a movie about the Three Kingdoms era alone. Yes, I see the irony here. However, it isn't. This is a Dynasty Warriors movie, which means you gotta do better than this. Guan Yu is a mountain of a man in the games, and his beard is immaculate, and his drip ain't bad either. None of that is translated to the movie, and Guan Yu isn't even my favorite character. He is the god of war and the second strongest character in the games. Even though I feel like he is sometimes overrated in the games themselves, I can't deny the man is a powerhouse. I feel really bad saying this because I'm sure the man who was casted to portray the Guan Yu character did his best, and in my opinion, he was pretty good outside of a few scenes. But I don't get that Guan Yu feeling from him, if you get what I mean. Which is a shame because the man gets a huge spotlight in the movie. Okay, I'm calm now. Now let me recalibrate and talk about the good characters. I thought the movie did a fantastic job with the depictions of Cao Cao, Lu Bu, Liu Bei, Hua Xiong, and Dong Zhuo. Cao Cao, in the Romance of the Three Kingdoms story, is depicted as a ruthless and ambitious warlord who would do damn near everything and anything in order to achieve victory. Every move he makes is calculated. Every word he utters has meaning, and it's very rare where you just catch him off guard. From the moment I met him in Dynasty Warriors 4, I never trusted him, and at some points he made me very uncomfortable. I thought the movie captured these qualities about his character perfectly as you see him lay the foundation for the powerhouse he would eventually become. Cao Cao had his hands on nearly everything in the movie, from the failed assassination of Dong Zhuo to the coalition himself. The man loves finding talented warriors to bring over to his side, as you can see by his interaction, aka fascination, with Guan Yu. Starting our relationship that will eventually save his life one day, if you've played any of the games from Dynasty Warriors 5 and on. In Dynasty Warriors, Cao Cao is basically the bad guy of the story, and if he's the villain, then Liu Bei is the hero. When I was younger, I loved playing the Shu storyline because of its rags to riches story and how Liu Bei fights for the people and the Han Empire instead of a lust for power. Now that I'm older, I play the Shu storyline first to just get it out the way. Which is a shame because Shu has some of the most powerful characters in the entire series roster, with Liu Bei's sworn brothers Guan Yu and Zhang Fei, the previously mentioned Zhao Yun, and the stalwart Ma Chao, just to name a few. Also, an honorable mention to Guan Yu's adopted son Guan Ping, but only the Dynasty Warriors 5 version. It's a shame to see what has happened to him as the series has progressed.
Look at the mask of my boy.
Anyway, with Liu Bei always being depicted as the good guy, there are some very interesting possible character directions which are not used to the detriment of the story. I loved how the story showcased Liu Bei's shrewdness. Like how he waited until the coalition had no choice before allowing Guan Yu to go out and slay Hua Shao. Plus, the hidden tension he has with Cao Cao was a delight to see. Especially since Cao Cao sees right through this good guy facade Liu Bei puts up. Because he can see that Liu Bei has a tremendous ambition laying there just waiting to be unleashed. I wish the game showcased this side of Liu Bei more. Especially when you sit down and actually examine his actual history and the number of coincidences that just have positive results for him. Such as the deaths of Tao Qian and Liu Biao, which both resulted in Liu Bei gaining significant power as a result. But this is just the musing of a Dynasty Warriors fan who's screaming into the void. There is one more character I want to highlight, but first I want to talk about other character portrayals I enjoyed even though they didn't really have a big chance to shine. Dong Zhuo and Yuan Shao are perfect examples of this. Yuan Shao was there because he needed to be mentioned. Other than that, I don't really have a lot to say. They really nailed his look from Dynasty Warriors 8, which is my favorite of the series. He'll be more important in the sequel if that is ever made. Dong Zhuo, on the other hand, he's just the overt villain of the story. In fact, he is the first true villain. Zhang Zhao and his yellow turbans were at least fighting against the corruption of the Han, even if the way they went about it was wrong. Dong Zhuo is a man of immense size. Hell, when he died, legends say he was so fat that when they lit his body on fire, his body burned for days. Legends aside, this is not a man you can trust at all. You wouldn't let him date your daughter. Hell, you wouldn't even let him borrow a couple bucks. You wouldn't even let him be your Uber driver home, let alone call you an Uber. This movie definitely captured his depravity, but in all honesty, it wasn't really that hard. Diao Chan was also shown and we got a glimpse of her impact in the story, but she isn't important enough for a deep dive into her character unless there's a sequel in the future. The last character I wanted to highlight is the man you should never pursue, Lu Bu. To all Dynasty Warriors fans watching this, just mentioning the man's name gives you some kind of PTSD.
No. Wait.
For the uninitiated, Lu Bu was basically like the first boss in every Souls-like game. The boss that you're in no way prepared for. Basically, he was like the grafted scion for Elden Ring. Emphasis on the was. These days, he's been nerfed to hell. Like I said at the start of this video, the Dynasty Warriors 4 series of games was my first introduction to the franchise, and there was nothing.
Nothing.
And I mean nothing.
Nothing at all.
That could have prepared me to face this man. Here I was thinking I was hot shit after thoroughly wiping out the yellow turbans, and I even beat Hua Shang in a duel in the previous battle at Si Shui Gate. Ironically, I was Guan Yu at the time. So of course I kept this train going as I approached Hu Lao Gate, and then this fateful cutscene plays.
Is that who I think it is? It's Lu Bu! Lu Bu's come to destroy us!
But the cutscene itself is not the problem. It's what happens after.
You dare face the mighty Lu Bu?
I'm in danger!
In Dynasty Warriors 4, the game featured a dueling system where the player was challenged by another officer to a mano-a-mano fight inside a wooden cage. So it's basically like a Hell in a Cell match. Anyway, after the cutscene, Lu Bu challenges me to a duel, and I obviously accept because I ain't no bitch. Plus, I beat Hua Shang, so what's the worst that could happen? Here's basically what happened after the duel started.
Steve, here he comes. Take that, sir. Behold, a grown man weeping like...
That? That was your plan? Are you crying?
Yes, I'm crying. He hit me with a chair.
I didn't stand a chance. Like, at all. I tried again.
You're ugly.
And again. But I eventually swallowed my pride and rejected the duel and ran away from him like the coward I was. If I was to describe Lu Bu in one word, it would be menace. If I could do it in two words, it would be absolute menace. Lu Bu has a reputation of being the strongest warrior of the Three Kingdoms era, and the movie understands this. Remember his pursuit of Cao Cao after the failed assassination of Dong Zhuo. The man was basically doing his best Thor impression by throwing lightning everywhere, and he shattered Cao Cao's sword like it was made of wet tissue paper, and then he threw it back at him. Then, to fully cement how much of a menace the man was, he cleaves the side of a mountain with his halberd and creates a landslide that enveloped Cao Cao. However, despite all his power, the man isn't too smart. You always gotta make sure the guy is dead before you walk away feeling triumphant. Lu Bu is a rabid dog, always looking for someone strong enough to challenge him. I just wish the man was more physically imposing. Also, I didn't like that they used his Dynasty Warriors 8 outfit. I'm just not a fan of it. But I digress. I enjoyed seeing what Lu Bu brought to the movie. It wasn't perfect, but I still had a lot of fun knowing that every time I saw him, something crazy was about to happen. Well, now it's time to be a negative Bobby. There were just some characters omitted from the movie that just bothered me as a veteran of the series. Why were Zhang Liao and the Xiaho brothers completely omitted from the film? Zhang Liao in particular really irked me given the man's future reputation, but I don't see why they didn't give him the same role as Zhang Fei in the movie. Speaking of Zhang Fei, you want to talk about a completely throwaway role here? The more and more I think about it, I really did not like how Zhang Fei was used in the movie at all. He's one of Liu Bei's sworn brothers for Christ's sake, and I think he has like 10 lines of dialogue for the whole movie. I also needed him to be more physically imposing as well, but at this point, I'm just beating a dead horse here. I understand Zhang Fei isn't the most complex character out there, but damn, you gotta do better than this. You would think the man is just a named NPC in the games. I wish the movie also touched on his rivalry, so to speak, with Lu Bu. Even though in all reality, it's basically just Lu Bu rolling his eyes every time he sees Zhang Fei open his mouth. Last, but certainly not least, is the depiction of the Sun family, which was entirely unacceptable. The future founders of the Wu Kingdom are basically treated as the redheaded stepchild of the story, even though without them, Cao Cao or Liu Bei would have conquered the land at certain instances of the story. Over time, I've grown to really like the Wu storyline and their big impact on the entire Dynasty Warriors story. The movie completely trivializes their impact. Remember during the story section where I mentioned that Sun Jian was the vanguard for the coalition forces? Well, Sun Jian found a lot of success initially in his battles with Dong Zhuo's forces. However, Yuan Shu, Yuan Shao's cousin, was jealous of this. Yuan Shu withheld vital supplies from Sun Jian, which led to his defeat as the conflict progressed. Sun Jian was able to regroup his forces, however, and was the first member of the coalition to enter the capital, and there he found the Imperial Seal. However, I've already mentioned this. I can't forget to mention some of Sun Jian's most notable subordinates such as Huang Gai, Chen Pu, and Han Dang, who are also missing. Huang Gai in particular was a notable inclusion since he's been a part of the playable roster since Dynasty Warriors 3. Sun Jian was also very active during the Yellow Turban Rebellion, but that entire conflict in the movie served as a showcase for Liu Bei and his brothers. In all fairness, the Wu storyline doesn't really start picking up until after the Battle of Hulao Gate, but damn, it really sucked to see them so disregarded, leaving a potential sequel to do a lot of heavy lifting that could have been done in this movie somehow. In terms of other notable stuff that needed to be mentioned, I enjoyed the charged arrow callback from the PS2 era of games in the first battle. I also thought the soundtrack was well done with them using songs straight from the games. Finally, and I probably should have mentioned this in the story section, but it just didn't fit there while I was writing the script, I did not like the inclusion of the Sword Castle, this mystical place where the Chosen get their legendary weapons that get stronger as they use them. Basically, this is like the story MacGuffin that the writers put into the movie, which shows how the playable characters of Dynasty Warriors get their weapons. I have never been a big fan of Destiny, especially when it's used in media incorrectly. It always seems to be used, well, incorrectly. And this may sound weird, but the Sword Castle was the most video game thing about the movie. When I saw this, I was immediately reminded that I was watching a video game movie. They didn't need to add this into the movie at all. Just let them have their weapons from jump and give more screen time to characters like the Sun family, for instance, who needed it. At least the mystical lady in the castle didn't discriminate, since she also gave a legendary weapon to other characters such as Lu Bu and Cao Cao. However, the inclusion of this castle was unnecessary, and it was really weird considering how grounded the movie really was. Well, outside most of the fight scenes. In conclusion, the Dynasty Warriors movie is not bad when I compare it to other video game movies I've seen, but I wonder if my bias for the actual series is affecting my judgment somewhat. It is definitely not as bad as it could have been, and I was pleasantly surprised to see the staff behind the movie try their best to stick to the source material while mixing in actual history. The action was wild enough to satisfy me, and they definitely didn't spare any expense when it came to capturing that 1 versus 1000 gameplay experience with the special effects, which is a staple of all Warriors games. The movie also did some setup for a sequel with the simmering Liu Bei and Cao Cao rivalry, the Sun family finding the Imperial Seal, and there is also the previously mentioned Diao Chan, who will be the source of conflict between Dong Zhuo and Lu Bu in a glorious pseudo honeypot scheme. While I don't think a sequel will ever come, I do see three stories that could be made into a sequel and in turn could be three separate movies by themselves. One movie could follow the escapades of the Sun family following the immediate aftermath of them finding the Imperial Seal in the capital and the struggles they suffer because of it. Another movie could literally be all about Lu Bu following the immediate aftermath of Hulao Gate once again. We would then see Jiao Chan's honeypot scheme in action, which would eventually lead to Lu Bu killing Dong Zhuo and being forced to leave Chang'an in the ensuing chaos. The last movie idea I had would cover Cao Cao's rise to power following the Battle of Hulao Gate. As you can see by my very simplified explanations, the story could head in a myriad of directions. If a sequel is ever greenlit, hopefully it will be directed by someone who understands the Dynasty Warriors series plus the historical time period the series is based on. Anyway, I guess I should rate the movie, huh? On a scale of yes, you should definitely watch this, to no, you shouldn't watch this, if you're a fan of Dynasty Warriors, then yes, you should definitely watch this. If you're looking for mindless fun, then yes, you should definitely watch this. However, if you're looking for a great historical epic about ancient China, then you should definitely not watch this and look elsewhere. So if you're looking for a surprisingly fun action movie with video games and historical elements, then Dynasty Warriors could be up your alley. Okay, wow. This movie review was a lot more work than I expected. As you can tell from the video, I love Dynasty Warriors. And it's one of the few video game series where I will buy the newest game that comes out no matter what. Oh, don't look at me like that. Some of y'all are paying $70 for a roster update every year.
You have no right to judge me.
Sorry, I got a little defensive there. The Warrior series itself has grown massively, with the Dynasty Warrior series itself gaining a sister series focusing on the Sengoku Jidai period of feudal Japan called Samurai Warriors. The Warriors formula also has a reach in anime as well, with series such as Gundam, Berserk, One Piece, Fist of the North Star, and Attack on Titan all getting the Warriors treatment. Fire Emblem and The Legend of Zelda also joined the wave as well. One day, I do plan to talk about the Dynasty Warriors game series in detail, especially since the disaster that was Dynasty Warriors 9. However, there has been way too much Dynasty Warriors talk by me for one day. But if you're interested in learning more about the series, check out Chris Gildart's channel named, Chris Gildart, for everything Warriors related, especially since this video will be coming out during his annual Musou Mei event. If you're a history buff like me and want to learn more about the Three Kingdoms period of China, then check out the channel Serious Trivia for some in-depth examinations of the period. This is where I came to learn how to pronounce all the names so that I could at least sound like I knew what I was talking about. Oversimplified also has another video on the period if you're looking to save time. You could also watch the 2010 drama ironically named The Three Kingdoms, which is based on the period, but please remember, this is a TV show, not an accurate source of historical information. But I did use some clips from the show as I was making this video. I really enjoyed the show, but it did take some time for me to really get into it. This could be the same for you, especially if you're not used to watching foreign media. If you watched the Dynasty Warriors movie, what did you think of it? Let me know in the comments. Also, don't forget, this video is part of a double feature with a new Why You Should Watch video on the anime The Eminence in Shadow. It was spectacular. So yeah, check out that video if you'd like, or you could check out what some of my friends and I thought of some of 2022's most notable anime. Thank you all for watching, and see you soon. Man, I need some water.